All it takes is one flight. We'd be in the same time zone. Looking through your timeline, seeing all the rainbows. I got an idea, and I know that it sounds crazy. I just wanna see ya. Oh, I gotta ask, do you got plans tonight? I'm a couple hundred miles from Japan, and I was thinking I could fly to your hotel tonight. Cause I can't get you off my mind. Can't get you off my mind. Can't get you off my mind. I could feel the tension. We could cut it with a knife. I know it's more than just a friendship. I can hear you think I'm right, yeah. Do I gotta convince you that you shouldn't fall asleep? It'll only be a couple hours and I'm about to leave. Do you got plans tonight? I'm a couple hundred miles from Japan and I was thinking I could fly to your hotel tonight. Cause I can't get you off my mind. Can't get you off my mind. Can't get you off my mind. Do you got plans tonight? I was hoping I could get lost in your paradise. The only thing I'm thinking about is you now. Cause I can't get you off my mind. Can't get you off my mind. I can't seem to get you off my mind.
Let's get lost tonight. Let's get lost.
I was thinking I could fly to your hotel tonight. Cause I can't get you off my mind. I can't get you off my mind. Do you got plans tonight, baby? I was hoping I could get lost in your paradise. The only thing I'm thinking about is you and I.
Hello, hello, everybody. I'm super excited for all of you to join me for tonight's Sonder Social. We have an exciting one for you tonight. So super excited for all of you to join me here today. I am Malika, and I will be leading you through tonight's Sonder Social, which is going to be focused around filling out your ikigai. So we'll dive into those pages in the journal today, but we'll break it down for you. We'll make it a little bit easier to kind of get to our ikigai, and we'll talk about what that means and all the fun things revolving that. So super excited for all of you to join me today. I am joined by our amazing co-facilitator, Katie, and she'll be popping into the chat. And so definitely say hi to her. She's a rock star, so she'll be joining me here tonight. And that's pretty much it in terms of how Sonder Socials go. For those that are new, make sure to set your chat to everyone. We want to make sure that as you're typing in the chat, the rest of the group can see. So sometimes Zoom likes to auto default to hosts and panelists, and I just want to make sure everyone has the opportunity to set that chat to everyone. But super excited to have you all here. And without further ado, let's go ahead and kick off tonight's Sonder Social. So this month's theme is imagination. And when I was thinking of imagination, I really thought about how we really use our imagination to represent possibilities other than our reality, to represent times other than our present and other perspectives than our own. And this is really where creativity in the mind comes to really play and flourish. So when I think of imagination, I really think of it as letting your mind wander into the realm of maybe something you may think is impossible. So I invite you to really think of imagination as the creative ability or ability to confront and deal with a problem, or even the act of forming a mental image that is not present to the senses and may have never been your reality. So I invite you to think of those definitions when you think of imagination, and we'll be diving into an imagination activity. So keep those in mind as we dive in, and we will start off with the agenda. So the first activity, I already gave you a little sneak peek there. We're going to start with an imagination activity, and then we'll go into all the beautiful things with Ikigai. We're going to spend a lot of time, the bulk of our time, on Ikigai, and then we'll close out tonight's Saunders Social. So let's start with the imagination activity. Okay. So first I want to talk about nirvana. Okay. So what is nirvana? Here on the slide, I wrote down, you know, nirvana is a state of perfect happiness, an ideal or idyllic place. So nirvana traces its roots typically from Buddhism, and it's really a transcendent state where suffering, desire, sense of self, and that is not in existence. And it's rather the subject that is released from those effects of karma and the cycle of death and rebirth. And it represents the final state of Buddhism. It's the eventual goal to enter into that perfect state. And what I want all of us to take some time here today is identify your own nirvana. Figure out, what is that idyllic place to you? So let's start off by maybe closing our eyes for a little bit. And maybe picture one of your favorite places that you've physically been to. And try to think about what made that place special to you. And what made it magical. And try to draw on maybe some of the senses. Is it something you're looking at? Is it something you feel? Is it something you smell in the air? What is it about that place that really provides you a sense of comfort or happiness? And try to draw on that place as inspiration. And when I invite you to open your eyes if you've closed your eyes, and using that space as inspiration, try to create an imaginary world. What would you add to it and make it your own personal nirvana? And I invite you to write it down and share it with the group. And you can write it down on a blank piece of paper, on a scratch paper, or on a blank page in your Silk and Saunders notebook. So with that, we'll take a few minutes and we will regroup and try to really think and imagine your nirvana.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you all for sharing your beautiful nirvanas with us. I had so much fun reading through them. There were a couple places by the ocean, some cozy cabins with fireplaces, some cottages and forests. I love all these beautiful settings. I think there's something about nature that's definitely calming for me as well. And when I was thinking about, you know, my personal nirvana, I definitely had a combination of kind of the woodsy forest, cozy feeling, mixed with something near the ocean where the waves are crashing, I think, and the sunset on the ocean. I think that's definitely a sight I love. And luckily, I live in a beach town, and on the Pacific coast, we, in the winter times, the sunsets are absolutely magnificent. They actually crash into the ocean. So definitely need to take advantage of that more since it's not too far away. But I loved reading through all of your beautiful nirvanas, and thank you so much for sharing with the rest of the group. And with that, we'll transition into our main event for this evening, which is Ikigai. So turn to page 14 in your Sonder social. Sorry, Sonder, your Silk and Sonder journal. Sorry, it's been a long day. And turn to page 14, and it has this Venn diagram, the Ikigai. And what we'll do is we'll first kind of discuss, you know, what is Ikigai? I can kind of break it down, and then we'll break down each of these circles, each of these four circles. So we'll break down what you love, what the world needs, what you can be paid for, and what you're good at. And we'll kind of break that down together, and then we'll identify our passion, our mission, our profession, and our vocation. So we'll go into that. And first, we'll start with, what is Ikigai? You all are too sweet, by the way, complimenting my laugh. Thank you. And first, I'll start with kind of, what is Ikigai? So Ikigai is said to have evolved from the basic health and wellness principles of traditional Japanese medicine. And this tradition holds that physical well-being is truly affected by one's mental and emotional and sense of purpose in life. And Japanese psychologist Michiko Kumano said that Ikigai is a state of well-being that arises from devotion to activities one enjoys. And it also brings this notion of fulfillment. So essentially, pursuing activities that produce enjoyment and give us a sense of mastery, and specifically, it alleviates a lot of negative emotions that we may hold within ourselves. And I think of Ikigai in the simplest term as a reason to get up in the morning. It's the sum of small joys in everyday life, and it results in a more fulfilling life as a whole, and essentially waking up to joy. And something that can result from Ikigai is this notion of flow. So flow can occur when you're doing something you love consistently, that you feel good at, and the possibility of added benefit brings value not only to your life, but it also brings value to others' lives. And it can be seen in this flow can be seen in tune with your Ikigai as you give your life more meaning and purpose. So it's important to note that ikigai is not referring to only your own purpose and fulfillment, but it also takes into account, you know, what the world needs, which is one of the sphere, the dimensions on the Venn diagram. And it is really just showing the overlapping nature of, you know, what you love, what the world needs, what you can be paid for, what you're good at, to really drive your ikigai. And what we'll go through first is kind of breaking down each of these spheres of dimension, and we'll take some time. I invite you to kind of find a piece of paper, either you know, a blank sheet or a blank page in your Silk and Sonder journal, to kind of help you brainstorm some ideas for each of these spheres, because the journal itself gives space for the intersection of those spheres, but it doesn't have space for what you love, what the world needs, what you can be paid for, what you're good at. You could also write directly into your journal just on the side of the diagram, but I'll leave that up to all of you. So with that, I will transition to the next slide. Okay, perfect. So this is, you know, before we begin, I want to acknowledge that this activity does take some time, but we're all here together and we're all going to make that start. And I think that's really beautiful. And I'm really, really happy that you all are joining me tonight as we identify our own ikigai. So we'll first start with what you love. The sphere includes what we do or experience that brings us the most joy in life, and it makes us feel the most alive and fulfilled. What we love in this sense might be drinking tea or journaling or going for a long walk outside. It could be diving into a wonderful novel. It can really be anything that you truly love. And what's important to note is when we think about identifying what we love, we identify what we love without concern of whether we're good at it. So for example, I really enjoy, you know, painting or doing something that involves art. I think it's a fun way to express emotion and creativity, and it's very soothing and calming for me personally, but in no way, shape, or form am I good at it. I think it's more of a like love where I don't really feel like I need to be good at it. It's more something that I enjoy doing. So really think of it as finding what you love without thinking about, you know, don't compare yourself in this with anything outside of what you love. Just try to focus and zero in on activities or things that you love, and without considering, like, you know, what you're good at, if the world needs it, or what you can get paid for. Think about just isolating what you love. So we'll take a minute and we'll write down what we love, and feel free, if you feel comfortable, to write in the chat what you wrote down. And then we will tackle the next section, which is what you're good at.
Thank you.
All right. I see people are sharing what they love, which is amazing. Thank you so much for writing that down and sharing. It's really beautiful and it's great to hear, you know, just identifying what you love. Sometimes it's fun to just think back and really think about what do you love, you know, what activities do you enjoy? And it's important that we give that time and attention to identify that section. All right, and now we'll move on to the second sphere, which is what you're good at. So this sphere is including anything that you may be particularly good at. So try to draw on the skills you've learned up to this point in life, maybe some hobbies you've pursued, talents that you have at an early age, what you're good at. For example, I think I started my journey with learning the piano at age 5, and I really stuck with it. And as I think I do have a lot of, I did nurture that talent and stuck with it. And because of that dedication, I think playing the piano is something that I'm pretty good at. It's hard to kind of say that with such, you know, confidence because I have been out of practice for a little while. But I definitely, you know, think that that's one of my strong suits, but it can really range in terms of what you're good at. It can be, you know, public speaking. It could be being empathetic amongst, people that you surround yourself with. It could be really anything that you think that you're good at, something that you feel confident in your capabilities, what your skills are, and what you've nurtured along the way throughout your life. So try to really think back and think about what you're really truly good at. And it can be talents, capabilities. It can be something that you may not even be passionate about, but you're still good at it. And it's good to acknowledge that. So try to take some time and think about what you're good at, and then we'll regroup in a minute.
Thank you.
right. I have been popping in the chat, and it looks like we have amazing skills throughout this entire group. And I'm definitely jealous of a lot of you. I wish I could, you know, use you all just to get some help on, you know, a lot of creative people, a lot of you know, really, really cool skills that you all have. So I definitely appreciate that. Some people, I think, also struggled with this the way I did. I definitely struggled with this section as well. It's sometimes hard for me to kind of think back and reflect just who I am. I just never really think about what I'm actually good at. It's usually I draw inspiration from what people in my life have told me I'm good at as like me recognizing it, which isn't probably the best way to do it, but it's hard for me just from my instincts to identify that. But that's kind of how I went about this section. So I encourage you to, you know, maybe even think back at maybe some compliments you've gotten in your life where you didn't realize that you were good at something, and write that down. I feel like if someone else acknowledged that, then it must be true. So that's probably kind of my little tip there. And the next section is what the world needs. So for this section, the world is really big, let's be real. So the world could be anything you define it to be. So it could be humanity as a whole. It could be a small community that you feel connected to. It can be really anything you want it to be. So think of the world within, you know, your definition. So I'll leave that up to you as to how you want to define what that means. And what the world needs really is based on your impressions or needs expressed by others. So the world might need, especially in today's times, a lot of medical staff. The world needs clean water. The world needs heating and air conditioning. The world needs, you know, people to help others in the community. You know, the world needs teachers to educate the young students. The world needs a lot of, you know, typical jobs that just are part of everyday life. So definitely think about that for this section. And this domain is the most connected with other people and doing what's beyond maybe your own need. So this one is taking into account the broader sphere within your own self. I'll leave everyone a few minutes to take some time and write down the section, what the world needs. I just love what people are saying already. Sustainability, humanity living in harmony with nature. Beautiful, Cassandra. The world needs beauty, kindness, empathy, caring, peace, and love. Carolyn, I love that. So pretty. So let's all take a minute to just write down what the world needs, and we'll regroup and finish out the last sphere. Thank you. All right. I love what everyone wrote in the chat. I think there's a lot that the world needs, as we can see. I think these are great, great, like responses to this sphere. There's just a lot that the world needs. So especially during this time, I think it really came to the forefront. So I love what all of you wrote in the chat. And finally, we'll move on to the next section, which is what you can get paid for. So in this dimension of the diagram, it refers to the world or society at large as well. And it involves what someone else is willing to pay you for and what the market will bear. So you might be passionate about writing a novel, or you might be good at, you know, maybe you're really good at yoga, or maybe you're really good at, I don't know, there's a lot of things you may be good at, but it might not necessarily mean you can get paid for it. But, you know, in today's world, I feel like there's a lot that you can get paid for, which is an exciting time to be in. There's a lot of, you know, different ways that you can be kind of make your own journey in life, which is beautiful. So this section really can, you know, even if you're not like a great writer, you can still find a way to get paid for it in some degree. So don't let that limit you. I think really think about this section and think about different things that you do, that you can do, that you can get paid for. So whether it be paid for your passions or talents, try to think about what you can get paid for. So we'll spend one more minute and then we'll move on to the fun section, which is going to be the intersections of each of these spheres. So I'll give everyone a minute and then we'll regroup and start on the next section. All right. So I hope everyone had time to write down their last sphere, what you can be paid for. And we'll now move on to the next step of the Ikigai, which is finding those points of intersection. So we'll turn back to our journals and turn to page 15. So this is now where we get to define our ikigai now that we've done that first step and we've identified what we love, what the world needs, what you can be paid for, and what you're good at. And when we think of ikigai, it's a state of being which could be difficult for some of us to embody at all times. But when I think of ikigai, I think of it as a representation of hope in leading a more fulfilling life in the way that I define it. So everyone's ikigai, the best part about this exercise is everyone's ikigai is so unique to them. And because each of us is going through each step of the process, we all have different passions, missions, professions, and vocations in life that really contribute to our ikigai. And it helps bring meaning, purpose, and fulfillment to our lives while also contributing to the good of others. And I love that, it's so unique to each of us and it represents our uniqueness in the world. So now what we'll do is we'll spend some time and identifying our passion, mission, profession, and vocation on page 15. So at the intersection of what you love and what you're good at is your passion. At the intersection of what you love and what the world needs is your mission. And at the intersection of what the world needs and what you can get paid for is your vocation. At the intersection of what you're good at and what you can get paid for is your profession. So initially, it was when I first looked at ikigai without understanding this concept, it was hard for me to really provide some sort of delineation amongst each of these terms, because I think colloquially we use these terms interchangeably, kind of in everyday life. So I will try to provide as much context so that there's a clear definition as we write down kind of our passion, mission, profession, and vocation. So your passion is really a strong feeling of enthusiasm or excitement for something or doing something. So that is how I thought of the word passion. Your mission describes what we do and how we do it. It identifies the benefits we deliver from our endeavors. And our mission can describe us in the present. It describes our purpose and the true north that points to our future. The vocation is a job or calling in which one is focused in doing a particular kind of work. And it's a work that one does because of a feeling of deep affinity or attraction to that talent. So that is what a vocation means. Vocation, the Latin root voc is like calling. So it's a calling that you're doing because the world needs it and it's something that you can be paid for. And then the profession is a job that one adopts and studies. And it typically refers to an intellectual pursuit. It can involve, either getting some training or qualification, think teaching. So it can overlap with vocation sometimes if it's also what the world needs and it's something that you can be paid for. But it can also be separate, right? It can also be like, I am working as a consultant because the business world needs it and it's something that I can pay for, but I might not be good at it. So that would be my profession. So if I wanted to write down what my profession is, it would be something that I've feel skilled in, I've done training in, I have some sort of background in, and I constantly commit to that training and want to really dive in and make that my profession. So that is kind of the delineation between profession and vocation. And sometimes they can overlap. So with that, I think Katie dropped a lot of those definitions into the chat. So we'll spend some time. We'll spend about a few minutes to write down our passion, mission, profession, and vocation. And it can really, you know, in terms of format of how you want to write this, I'll leave that up to you. It can be bullets. It can be written as like a free flow. And we'll go from there. Yes. I think some people want definitions. I think Katie's popping those in the chat. So, take a look at those, as you write this down, and then we will all regroup in a few minutes, but also if you feel comfortable, share your passion, mission, profession, and vocation with us. Would love to see what you wrote down in the chat, and we'll regroup shortly.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. I love what everyone's sharing in the chat. It's just, I have such warm feelings right now because I think it's amazing that we all are just having those feelings of, aha. I think that's kind of what happened to me when I did this exercise. It's pretty incredible what happens when you kind of find, you know, identify these four cornerstones that represent our ikigai. And we start with, you know, what we love, what the world needs, what you can be paid for, what you're good at, and then finding those intersections of passion, mission, profession, and vocation. It essentially guides our ikigai and our purpose in life that's so unique to us. I think of ikigai as like serving as our northern light, and it can serve as a guide for each and every one of us to live a life and appreciate the joys that life can bring to us by really grounding into our ikigai, which is what we've done today. And, you know, without even realizing, kind of tying back into the theme of imagination, we've really woven in those threads of imagination within our own reality. You know, we've really gone and identified maybe things that you might not have recognized right away in your current reality, but you've written them down and you've kind of identified that first step that makes that imagination, it makes the impossible possible for you. So I really commend each and every one of you for diving into your ikigai today. And I just really am so proud of each and every one of you all for investing time in the social and really deconstructing ikigai with me and helping me also learn from all of you how you wrote down what you love. You all give me so much inspiration. So thank you so much for just kind of doing this prompt with me. I think it's definitely a fun one to do, and it's definitely an aha moment for me as well. So I'm glad that we all kind of agree that there is something so impactful with this prompt. So thank you all. And thank you for being patient with me. I added those definitions last minute. So thank you so much for being patient. And I hope that that helped. And then now it's a few minutes past the hour. So thank you all so much for joining me this evening. Please, if you haven't already, definitely download the Silk and Sonder app and share your experience, your ikigai with the broader Silk and Sonder community, not just the one that attended here tonight. So definitely pop in there. I will definitely be popping in there. So we'll look out for all of you. So make sure to download either the iOS or Android app. Katie just dropped in some links as well. And then last but not least, we have a feedback survey that we send out after each social. So definitely be sure to fill that out. We always take feedback, you know, and we want to kind of tailor these events to best serve you. So we read each piece of feedback. And if you have any ideas or anything else that you want to see from us as your facilitators, we want to make sure that we kind of identify those needs and wants from the rest of the community. So thank you so much for joining me here tonight. And I hope that you have an incredible rest of your week. And hopefully we'll see you at my next Sonder Social. Thank you, everyone.
When the stars are born, they possess a gift or two. One of them is this: they have the power to make a wish come true. When upon a star makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme. When you wish upon a star, as dreamers do, fate is kind. She brings to those who love the sweet fulfillment.